Okay. We're doing this.
I'm so used to doing this by myself.
Back to my channel, a new video, a new day, and today I have a lovely guest. It's Sauda. I'm so excited that she's here and we finally can make like a sit down video since we've been talking about doing this for such a long time. And she's leaving today. She's going back to Zimbabwe, so I'm just catching her before she leaves so we can do this Q&A about basically about what we feel about living in Africa and our experiences and yeah, and share that with you guys. So it's gonna be a little bit of Tanzania, a little bit of Zimbabwe. Yeah, how do you feel?
I feel kind of nervous, you know, I don't do these kind of things, so. I guess there's no right or wrong for the questions. It's your own experience.
So. Exactly. It's basically our, yeah, guys, this is our personal experiences. So what we've gone through is not necessarily what you guys are going to go through. We're just sharing what we have been through while being here. So I think without further ado, we can just get straight into the questions. And these questions are, by the way, a combination of what I've seen in comment sections, what you guys want to know, and also what kind of what I thought would be interesting. Hey. Should we start?
Yeah,
I'm ready. So the first question, why did we choose to move to Africa? Mm-hmm. And I think you can start.
Well, I think it's like you get this, it feels like home. Coming to, I mean, I feel like if I go to Tanzania, if I go to Uganda, Ghana, Zimbabwe, I feel like there's this feeling of belonging, which I wouldn't necessarily feel in my own home country, which is Sweden. But here it's just this kind of, I mean, the vibe. And I think it's very important to have people that are similar to you, that look similar to you. Like, you see your own reflection, you see people like powerful black women in like these high positions, and you feel inspired. But then if you go to Sweden, you don't, you feel like it's a fight to get to these kind of position. But then if you go to those position, you have to explain yourself all the time. And I feel like here I could just be like, I can be like black, without having to explain why I'm here as a black person. I'm just am me. So I feel I like that with the African vibe, with Zimbabwe, if it's here.
Yeah.
I just like, it feels like home, basically. My conclusion. What about you?
With me, it was, I mean, sort of the feelings that you're feeling. Mm-hmm. And also, I've just had a dream for like so many years that I want to try to live in Africa and just get that experience and learn more about my heritage, and have like an option of being among people that you said look like myself, and in these very inspiring settings that I don't necessarily get in Sweden. And I have another video where I talk specifically about these questions, so I'm gonna link this in the description box but also in a card right here so you can go and watch that video.
But let me add something, because also if you look at the scene where it's happening, you can see that Africa is on the like map right now. Mm-hmm. There's so many things happening in terms of like the music industry, in terms of development, economically development. So you just want to be in that space and be a part of that development. And in Europe, is this that development, that phase already passed.
Yeah.
So we weren't a part of that. Because before it was all of these negative images, like Africa this, you're African, and now it's like finally the positive images are coming and we are like contributing.
Exactly, and we're in the middle of it.
We're not looking at those things that are happening. We are in the here, like experiencing it. For example, me, I experienced the election in Zimbabwe. I experienced the coup.
Crazy.
Have a debate about
That's historical.
It's historical things. Like if I was in Sweden, the most historical thing would be like going to the library and reading about these things. So it feels amazing.
Was it easy to get friends? Was it easy or hard to get friends?
That's a difficult question. I feel like it's easier getting male friends than female friends. particularly here in Tanzania, mm-hmm. I felt like it was easier to get guy friends than girlfriends. In Zimbabwe, vice versa. But I feel like I have more female friends now in Zimbabwe.
Yeah.
Yeah. It wasn't. I don't know why. Maybe because. And where I worked here, there was a lot of like male colleagues that I had.
Yeah.
So obviously, like they have more male colleagues friends. So if they would introduce me, it would be like to their male colleague friends.
Right.
But in Zimbabwe, I had female friends, like colleagues as well. So it was easier for me to like, you know, find friends like that.
Yeah.
But naturally, I would say yeah, it's difficult.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
people are more like. I don't know, they have their clique already and they're you come as a foreigner. You have to start over.
Yeah.
Finding some people to hang with them.
Yeah.
I remember I used to like go on Tinder find like looking for friends or like couch surfing because I was like I need
couch
someone.
Surfing as well.
I was like I need friends.
Oh my god, yeah. That is so funny that you say that because I've had like the same experience where yeah. it is kind of hard getting friends, not necessarily because of the place we're in, but also everywhere. I think when you're older and coming in new to a place, it's really hard to make lasting friendships. My whole life I've always had it so easy to get girlfriends.
Yeah.
I never had very many male friends, but here it's been predominantly male friends or guy friends that I've had. But slowly by slowly I'm getting to know more girls and I'm holding on tight to them. Next person. How easy or hard is it to get a job in Africa, or let's say in Zimbabwe and Tanzania? In Tanzania specifically, my experience is, and what I've heard also from other people, that it is extremely hard to get a job, especially in the private sector. It is very, very hard. Even local Tanzanians find it difficult to find jobs. Like, I'm talking about college graduated people, they have their degrees and everything, but they just don't get jobs. They work for like as interns for free for like a year before they get like something small. Those non-Tanzanians that I see that have a job, they usually work in NGO, so in the NGO world, as diplomats in some type of embassy, or what else? Yeah, those are basically the main two things. And some of them have like their own businesses. A lot of the restaurants and hotels in Zanzibar, for example, foreign owned. So that's usually the activity. So in private companies, the only reason for them to take you giving somebody a working visa or residency is quite expensive. So you have to have a really specialized skill that they can't find elsewhere for them to take you on. In the private sector. So to be honest, Tanzania is quite difficult to get a job, but yeah, that's my experience.
Well, my experience is, so I basically here as I'm representing, or I'm sponsored or funded by my government, so basically I'm not really employed by the Zimbabwean government. And even when I was working in Tanzania, I wasn't employed by the government in Tanzania, so it was always like the Swedish government who funded me and I worked here. I don't know, this should be a topic to discuss because I want to know your opinions, but also I feel as a foreigner, when you come in with a foreigner background of education, like I studied in England or I studied in Sweden, it looks better on your resume, so they would hire you over a local.
Right.
They see like it's something, you know, oh, he studied abroad or whatever, so you know,
yeah.
It's much better. He's
very
from abroad.
True.
So I feel like if I would apply for a national post that was open for international, that I would get it because of my experience as someone who's international. Someone gave me the perspective that, well, you come in with your foreigner, like your foreign knowledge, and then you like, you kind of give that kind of experience, and this is their only way of getting that kind of experience.
Right.
So it's kind of good, but
mm-hmm.
then you're like, I don't want it. No.
I think it's a two-edged sword because
yeah.
We don't want to experience like brain drain from Africa.
Exactly.
So it's nice, like I feel it's good
coming
that
back.
The Spartans come back.
But at the same time, you don't want to take the positions of the actual locals that live
here.
Yeah, and we're trying and struggling to get this job, and then you come and be like, hi,
yeah,
I just put in a CV and, you know.
And then I get it, yeah.
You don't want to be that kind.
So actually, that's a question for you guys.
Yeah, what do you think?
What do you think about that? Next question, guys. So, is it easy to get housing in Africa or in Tanzania or Zim? Should I start or you?
Yeah, you start.
Okay, so to be honest, I'm quite lucky. I have roots in Tanzania, so my father lives in Tanzania. Basically, there was nothing hard about getting housing because it was our family house. In general, for people who have no connection at all to Tanzania, I mean, I think it's easy if you can. It's quite okay, actually, depending on where you like the standard of living that you have. You can find very cheap places. Most people, international people, live in places like Masaki or Oyster Bay or Mikocheni. The prices in Masaki have been going down a little bit. I know like a two-bedroom apartment in Masaki would cost like $1,500 per month. To me, that's expensive, but that's prices going down. That's like the area where all the embassies are, all the NGOs, all of those. And that's $1,000 per month in like a two-bedroom place. And that's the lowest you'll get, pretty much.
Yes, I agree with most things you said. I mean, you can always, it depends what kind of living standard you want. You can always go on Airbnb and like find a cheap place to place. And always, if you're gonna stay for long term, you can always make an agreement with your landlord. So I think that's easy. However, like in terms, something you have to consider when you live in African continent is the security, where you live,
yeah,
but also what kind of security you have. If you have electric fence, if you have a guard, like what kind of things do you have? Because me, I'm always like, safety comes first, so I'd rather pay extra money to be safe than to be sorry.
Okay, so the next question, which is cost of living, which I kind of touched on about when it comes to housing, but you can add cost of living for like food and transportation, for example, in Zim.
I think it's very expensive. It's too, like, no way. I always ask the nationals, like, how do you guys survive? Because it's so expensive.
Yeah.
I would say that the prices are very similar to Sweden. But you're thinking, because I am in Africa, I'm in Zimbabwe, these prices will be cheap. And also, since we use American dollars, it's like ridiculously expensive.
Yeah. So. Even I remember that, yeah. I found like,
you went to the supermarket and you're like, a soy sauce, this small, $8, like nah, what is this?
No. Yeah, no, it's quite crazy in Zimbabwe. But
it's because of the economy and
And the inflation and everything. So here in Tanzania, food, you can get extremely cheap. It really depends. If you want to go to all these like fancy restaurants that serve Western food, you're gonna pay a lot of money. But like if you buy from your local market out here, you get four tomatoes.
Or and we want to support the locals.
We want to support the locals. So in my area, they actually, like, the market is more expensive than if you would go to like Kariakoo or something where it's a bigger market. But like five tomatoes for 1,000 shillings, you get like three carrots for 1,000 shillings. Yesterday I actually got five tomatoes for 500 shillings, so that was half the price. But I think the lady who works there kind of likes me now. So food, groceries is quite cheap. If you go to the supermarket with imported goods, it's expensive. Mm-hmm. So local foods is always cheap. Even like my lunch restaurant at work, I pay like 3,500 shillings for lunch every day. It's quite cheap.
But also what I've noticed in terms of like vegetables and food, like the further you go to like to the village, it's cheaper
than
if you buy it in town. So if you want to make a shopping, whatever, or if you're going outside of the big capital city, then you should pick up some fruits or whatever on the way, because it's obviously cheaper.
Transportation. I mean, if you're going to go with the Daladala, which is the local transportation, it's 400 TZ shillings per bus that you take, depending on, some buses are, I've seen like 500 shillings, but yeah, 400 shillings. So yeah, so in Zimbabwe, cost of living can be quite expensive. In Tanzania, very expensive. In Tanzania, when it comes to food transportation, quite cheap. Housing, depending on your levels, it can get expensive here as well. Do you miss Sweden? That's the next question.
I feel so bad every time everyone asks me this question. Sometimes I do, but then that fades away very quickly. I miss my family and my friends, but I feel like, I mean, my friends can always come and visit me and my family as well somehow, or I can visit them. But I miss maybe stability sometimes. I feel pretty comfortable being outside of Sweden. I feel like I grow more as a person, and I can be the fully person who I am. Because in Sweden we have something called Jantelagen, which are, like, always put you, like, you have to be, like, in the middle. And I feel like also as a black person there's a different expectation. When you do something good, everyone praises you. But when you do something bad, it's like the whole, like, everyone is against you. Like, oh, why are you in your country? Then you have to defend yourself. And I don't like that feeling that you can't just be who you are. You always, like, you always have to, like, explain yourself or defend yourself. So I don't miss that feeling at all, which I don't have here. But yeah, sometimes I miss it, sometimes.
You know, yeah.
Most of the time, I don't think about Sweden so much.
Yeah. Even me, I'm not really thinking that much about Sweden. The only thing that I miss is my friends and my family, my mom and my sisters.
And also, I remember when I was living in Sweden, because this narrative of Africa that you either see like these babies with like swollen stomachs, or you see like old people. And I was missing like the youth of Africa. And now it's like, those are my friends. Like, yeah. I am, and they're doing such amazing things. Like, you never see this portrait of youth in Africa. So
and how energetic they are, and how innovative.
It's like, where's that image? It's not only the babies with swollen and thighs.
Yeah.
And the criminals, the rebels or whatever, like.
Yeah. People have lives living normal things, like going to work, going, have a drink with their friends.
But basically, like, doing the same thing, if not more, that we would be doing in Sweden, like a social life. There's a social scene that is just.
No, you were not out there yesterday.
No, I wasn't.
Okay, next question. How long do you plan to stay in Africa or Zimbabwe or,
I was actually talking to you about this before. Like, I don't really have a plan, but because I see myself being here for a while. Maybe if I get like a child or something, then I'll go home and, you know, the baby. And otherwise I see myself here for maybe 10 more years or like forever if that's possible.
Yeah, my current plan right now is till June next year, and then we'll see where life takes me. Like, Tanzania compared to Zimbabwe, what's the biggest difference?
I feel like the vibe is different in East Africa to Southern Africa. Obviously, like, the people, the music, but for me the biggest thing is that I miss when I'm in Zimbabwe is the vibe, and that's why I'm like, I need to go to Tanzania, and that's why I'm here, because I miss this African, East African vibe, and this familiarity of like the similar the culture that I'm used to, that I'm brought up with.
So are there a lot of diasporans in Tanzania or Zim? I can start. Maybe there are, but I haven't met them, and I really haven't made an effort to meet, so I'm not sure. I want to say no, that there's not that many diasporans here.
In Zimbabwe, I think there's a lot of diaspora. I am not Zimbabwean, so I don't want to speak on the behalf of the Zimbabweans. But I feel like there's especially a lot of people from England that are coming back and starting their own things and doing big things. And I feel after the coup, whatever, a lot of people saw like potential, and like a lot of people wanted to go back, because Zimbabwe is a beautiful country and it has so much potential. It's just that the economy is bad. If the economy wasn't bad, I think that a lot of Zimbabweans would move back. And also SA is very close, so there is a lot of Zimbabweans that go between SA and Zimbabwe. And
what's SA?
It's South Africa.
SA. Okay.
So a lot of Zimbabweans go there, and I've seen like other people, like for example Ugandan Zimbabwean or like Indian Zimbabwean, which is cool.
Okay, what is your favorite thing with living in Africa?
Okay, being surrounded by black people doing amazing stuff. It's amazing. The life you have is quite different. I feel like in Europe everything has to be planned, while here it's okay if everything doesn't work out as they were intended to work out.
Yeah.
But in Europe, it's like, no, we have to follow the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Yeah.
Well, here it's like, oh, okay, I did 1, 2, 3, didn't work out, but at least I did 4.
Yeah. So, yeah.
I feel like I can't, every time people ask me, I can't really
pinpoint it,
but
it's hard.
I feel good, you know?
Exactly. It just feels good.
It feels good. Like, period.
Yeah. Okay, well, what is your least favorite thing with being here?
Corruption?
Corruption.
Also the injustice, actually seeing poverty like hands on, that's very disturbing.
Yeah.
For me.
Yeah. For me it's like, oh my god, it's more of like a selfish reason. Mm. And it's starting to go away anyway. But a lot of it was in the beginning for me, my least favorite thing was being, I felt less independent here than in Sweden. Especially because of language barrier. My Kiswahili is not perfect. And, you know, I'm always so used to being able to express myself in a pretty good way. And when I'm reduced to expressing myself in a language which is on a level of like a 10-year-old or something, it gets really frustrating, and it made me very intimidated on how to move around by myself. And also when it came to transportation, like before I like had that car and could drive around in that car and felt comfortable enough to drive in this crazy traffic, it was just, I felt very isolated and dependent.
That you needed someone else.
I needed someone, yeah. Exactly, in order to do things. And that made me really like, I was really close to being like, you know, I'm done, I'm going back to Sweden, where I know everything, I know how to maneuver, I know, like, I can go from the tip of the country to the south of the country with no help whatsoever, whereas I didn't feel that way here.
Yeah, I had the same problem when I first came to Tanzania and I was living here.
Yeah.
And it was like this fear of just going out in the unknown, not knowing the language and anything, and you're alone, you're a woman, so you're like, okay, how I would be portrayed for the people and stuff like that. And one thing that I don't like also, since you don't understand language very good, like, you know you're getting ripped off sometimes.
Yeah.
And you like, you want to do something but you can't, so you're just like, okay, I'm gonna get ripped off, doesn't feel good, but at least I know I'm gonna get ripped off.
Yeah. Some,
like, I don't know how much, but yes, because I don't know the price, I don't know the language, I'm just gonna give you my money and at least I'm safe.
Yeah. So,
but yeah, so you get. I guess you get over that. Those are just minor things, I guess.
Yeah. Yeah. You absolutely, as
you learn, you live.
You learn as you like put yourself out there more and more.
Yeah.
What tips would you give for people who want to make the leap?
One thing I would do is check up the visa before you apply.
Oh my god! I've learned visa.
Look up the visa. Number one. Like, for example, Tina has an experience in Ghana.
I'm gonna make a video about that. So how important it is with visas.
Visa, it's not as easy as traveling around Europe. It's not.
I thought it was like that. Like, nope. Oh yeah, you can just travel around. Have your passport, whatever. No.
If you have a European or I guess American or whatever, not African passport, maybe African as well, you have to look up where. Like, how is the visa, how in terms of visa, like, what do you need to do? What do you need? Some places are more strict than others, so look that up. Otherwise, I would recommend people to do it. Just, like, don't listen too much to what other people have to say. Just go out there and make your own perception of the country. You might like it, and then you might find somehow a means to stay for a longer time.
Yeah, my tip is, like, okay, so for traveling, whatever, just as visa say, that Sauda said, visa, check out your visa. And especially if you want to go to several African countries around, you need to check visa for each country, which I didn't do. And then when it comes to just like, either if it's visiting or being here for a longer period of time, whatever African country, or actually this applies to any country really, just have an open mind.
Yeah.
Cultures are different.
Don't come with this perception, I know all this, I read this, I've heard
the
that.
Exactly. Don't do that, because you will be deeply disappointed. That's going to be a losing battle, I can tell you.
Yeah.
Because they already set norms and cultural norms and just the way things people do here. You can't just come and change things just because you think you know things best. Whether they actually are best or not. But when I like went with the flow and okay, this is how things work here, and you try to maneuver within those that framework, then you are going to have a much better time.
And it's also dangerous to have this fairy tale, like African motherland queen, they're gonna treat me like a princess. That is also dangerous. So just be open-minded and, you know, don't expect too much.
Yeah. This is just people who don't know you, who don't have the same ideas as you.
Don't expect too much. I mean, you will have some ups and you'll have some downs. So be ready for the downs. Not everything is gonna be perfect. You will get ripped off. You will probably experience corruption, like police asking for money, whatever. Just be aware of that, okay? Don't start like being starting troubles because police wanted money and nah. Like, just like what I usually do, I look what the local people do, and
yeah.
Then you like try to like behave as a local or whatever.
That's the best way, honestly.
Yeah, to survive, learn from the locals.
How's relationship life in Africa? Okay, let me start. In Tanzania, dishonesty is a big thing, and when I say dishonesty, not in the terms of people are trying to be malicious or mean or anything, but it's just a thing that people may say white lies all the time. So having a relationship here is to me something that seems very, very difficult, and I just can't handle a man that is have those typical traits that Tanzanian men can have sometimes, which is lying. And also women, I shouldn't say it's just men. Men, it's just like a thing. You, rather than hurt somebody's feelings, you just cover up, say a lie basically. So cheating and stuff is very common. I think dating life can be fun here, but I wouldn't take it too seriously. And yeah, I'm gonna leave it at that.
Well, I would say that I feel like as a black woman, a woman of color, you get more attention in the African continent than you would get. In Sweden, for example, or I was talking to my other friend living in the States about the issue of colorism as well. Like, obviously there is colorism in Africa, but I feel like even I feel like in Europe, in Sweden in particular, the beauty is in the white, like the white person, the European. So you have a lot of white people going for Europeans, but also a lot of like black people going for Europeans. While here is most like they'll be like, the African woman, the African body. Oh, you know, we want a sister. I had a friend who was like, "Oh, you've gained some weight," and I was like, "I was like, no, it's a good thing.
Yeah.
Like, keep on eating. Like,
so yeah, like, eat."
It's quite different.
That's what I felt coming to TZ as well.
Mm-hmm.
That our beauty is definitely celebrated in a way that I have never experienced in Sweden. I mean, when I say never, like, I'm not talking about individual people who might like be attracted to you or whatever.
But one thing I want to add is, for example, in Sweden, you have this statement, "You're pretty for a black girl." Well, here you would have like, "Oh, but you're international." You know, you're international Tanzanian or international Ugandan. And that is also like,
it's exotifying somebody.
Exotifying, like, and saying like, what about the locals? Like, what do you mean about that?
So yeah,
that is also one important thing to address. And one thing that I've also noticed is, in terms of relationship, is that a lot of times the person forgets that you have some Swedish values. So those things will collapse because they see a black lady, so they will think like, oh, she's raised Tanzanian and she's raised like Tanzanian values. So sometimes those kind of things will crash.
Oh my god, I had no more questions. Do you want to add something or?
No, I mean, people can leave things in the
comment below and
say what they
think. Are you also going to answer comments?
Yeah. I will ask Sabrina.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, so I will read them and then send the replies to Tina because I'm not really a YouTube person. But I like being on Tina's channel. So.
I'm so happy.
That's the only time I'm here. So yeah.
Perfect. I am so happy that you could be here today, Sauda. You're leaving like in 1 hour.
Yeah.
Thank you guys for watching this. This is going to be a long video. I'm actually going to try not to cut out very much because I want you to hear as much of the conversation as possible. If you enjoyed this video, this topic, this discussion, please give this video a big thumbs up. Share this video with people that you think would find this interesting. And of course, subscribe if you're not subscribed yet. Otherwise, I will catch you in my next video.
Have a lovely day, everyone.
Goodbye, guys. I live and die in Africa.